episode 78, 5-1 movie and TV scores. Hello and welcome to this week's episode of 5-1. 5-1 is all about the countdown from our panel of experts on a different topic each episode. Today, we are featuring our favorite movie and TV scores and our style of counting down from
5-1.
You made one mistake.
What's that?
So, the song, was it supposed to be a cover?
It is a cover.
Well, it's actually an original song.
It's not an original. It's a cover. Jet found this somehow that he won't explain, some way he won't explain, and has been listening to it.
It's on TikTok.
Lot.
No, it's not.
The song is on TikTok.
No, it's not. It's not anywhere on TikTok.
Yeah, it is.
It's not.
All right. Well, anyways, okay. It's catchy. So we played it for our intro song because I didn't know like what theme song to play because I don't want to play one that we might have in our list. So I chose this one. Whatever. A couple of quick things before we start. We are on Spotify, and our Facebook page is still down. That's all I have to say about that. So, Jet, what do you usually say when you're ready to go to the next topic?
Moving on.
I'm going to try to get that in a soundbite.
Clip.
Yeah, so we'll just have it ready. I thought about doing it before this episode, but then I'd have to like go back and listen to an episode to find
and
one.
And record it.
And, well, I have it recorded. I just have to isolate it and make it a...
Oh.
Yeah, it makes sense. Anyways, moving on.
Well, I have a couple of examples to use already here for the next episode. Before we get much further, let's introduce our panel of scoring experts. I am CK, and I am joined by my two scornful sons.
Cade Moore.
That's my 16-year-old.
Jet Moore.
My 13-year-old, and we are...
5-1.
5-1. I'm 39, by the way. I said your ages, so I thought I'd say mine too. 39, I say...
Happy birthday.
Happy birthday.
I'm actually 40 as well. I mean, my birthday started like 5 minutes ago.
I was the first.
You were.
But what time were you actually born?
I was born at 10:08 p.m., so I still have...
So you're still 39 for like a whole nother day.
Almost, yeah. I have like 22 hours before I officially turn 40.
Whatever.
But my birthday started 5 minutes ago, and there's nowhere I'd rather be celebrating my birthday than here with you guys recording. This is my favorite thing to do, so thank you for doing this for me tonight. Capiche?
Capiche.
All right, let's do a little bit of...
Feedback!
So the trivia episode was a hit. Lots of people seem to like it a lot, yeah. So it's something we will continue to do. I already have another one kind of in the works. When I say the guys, I mean the guys that have listened to our show from episode one and still listen to every episode, they suggested that we do a tournament of champions at some point.
That would be really fun.
Yeah, so we can bring back prior guests and have them on and competing against each other. So that'll be in our future, so be on the lookout for that. We got a new review on iTunes, which is always fun. It was titled Binge Worthy, and it was written by user Stephanie Perez 23. This podcast is such a fun time. Father and sons team up with their top fives on everything pop culture, and I loved it. Chris is such an enigmatic storyteller, and his sons are so intelligent, well-spoken, and hilarious. I don't know what show she was listening to. I laughed, I learned, and I yelled at my phone so much that I binged the entire episode catalog in 2.5 weeks. Whoa. I can't wait for new episodes. That's impressive. Awesome.
Thank you.
Right? Isn't that awesome?
So cool.
This is our 78th episode. That's 77 episodes.
You said that?
In 2.5 weeks?
In 2.5 weeks, which, you know, we run about an hour a show, and our early shows are actually longer than that. So that's some that's serious really cool. Binge listening. So thank you for that. We really, really do appreciate it. So before we get started, when I posted the listener choices question, I noticed a lot of people selected for their choice soundtracks instead of scores, which... Just to provide clarity on my choices and probably your guys too, because we're all kind of like similar in our film and pop culture knowledge. Mm-hmm. I only considered scores, not soundtracks for this list. And I defined score as a piece of original music made to accompany the visuals of a film, different than a soundtrack, which uses like pre-existing songs and puts them in a movie.
I did scores too.
Okay, good. So it looks like we all did the same thing. If there's confusion when it comes to our list, just think of score as like background music that provides atmosphere or environment or emotion. not like
Linkin Park playing
Transformers. Exactly. It's not like a rock or rap song you've heard on the radio, right? That's different. That's soundtrack. Anyways,
soundtracks.
We that is another list I want to do for sure, but it's not this list. But a lot of
would
our,
you put Linkin Park in your top five?
No, I'm not a Linkin Park fan. Did you guys have any rules for your list?
Just scores,
Jet?
Yeah.
I had one rule in addition to being scores. I did not want five John Williams scores, which I very easily could have done.
I feel like that could be a whole different podcast.
So I have some in here that aren't John Williams, but it was hard to, I mean, still 60%
of mine. I ignore that, and I just picked the songs I liked.
Okay. I'll say 3 out of 5 of mine are still John Williams, even though I tried not to do it. So, all right. Well, I guess we can get started with our list. How far in are we?
6 minutes.
So that's pretty good. It's before 10 minutes. Mm-hmm. We're usually at like the 10-minute mark. So let's get started. Cade, what's your...
Number 5.
My number 5 is... I'll just play it.
Wow.
Oh, I know this. Terminator.
Mm-hmm. That's my number 3.
Number 3. Nice. I love this one.
So this is not John Williams.
Yeah.
Who is it?
Brad Fiedel.
Okay. I've heard the name.
Fiedel?
I would not have thought of it.
This, out of all my choices on my list, this one makes me feel probably the most nostalgic out of all of them.
Okay.
Like, Star Wars doesn't really make me feel nostalgic.
It does for me.
Well, I watch it all the time. When I feel nostalgic, it's something I haven't done in forever. I was saying this the other day. Those white powdered donuts you see, I don't know what they're called. Whenever I eat it, I don't taste anything but nostalgia.
Reminds you of...
Because I haven't had it in forever.
Reminds you of your... Even forever, and forever for you means like in a month.
Yeah, exactly. But, yeah. You know, if I watch Star Wars every week or every, like, 2 weeks, I never feel nostalgia because I'm always doing it.
Yeah.
I'm always watching it.
Yeah, I watched Star Wars today.
So I... Unless I watched, like, a Clone Wars episode I hadn't seen in 7 years.
Right.
Maybe then I'd feel nostalgic.
Watching the Clone Wars again was very nostalgic.
Yeah.
Very nostalgic.
Doing that again. Kind of like when we watched Avatar.
Yeah.
Yeah.
That was, really nostalgic for me, too.
Yeah.
But when I was researching for this episode and I heard this, I'm like, this is going to be on my list because it's so nostalgic for me.
Yeah. You were way into this movie for
a long time.
A while. Yeah.
Still in my top 10.
I think you were like 4 for Halloween when you dressed up.
Of course I was 4.
Of course you were 4. When you dressed up as the T-800 for your Halloween costume, you were a zombie that year.
I remember that.
Both of your costumes were sick
awesome.
That year.
I know, yeah. That was a good year.
We found you a suit that actually fit, and we like scuffed it up.
Where did we find that?
It was, I don't know, thrift shop probably, but it fit you. And we scuffed it up, and we made it look like you just crawled out of the grave.
I remember that.
And we had the makeup on your face and everything.
I was dancing.
Yes,
I did dance.
You did dance in it. And Jet, you were Terminator. You had a black leather jacket, which we also found.
That we got from, what's the family's name?
The Bakers.
Bakers, yeah.
Yeah.
It was really good, too.
It was. And your hair slicked back, because we didn't want to like cut your hair because you had really long hair at the time, but we kind of slicked it back, and you had the bullets going across your chest.
Too.
Yeah, you had shades, and you had a leather jacket that we also found at a thrift store. Like, lucky find,
we
right?
We should find that. I'd start wearing it again.
We have it still, but no, you cannot fit in it. Definitely not. But, yeah, Terminator.
Definitely our best year for costumes.
For sure, yeah. That was a really fun year.
And, did he go to, like, a class party?
He did.
Like
he went to a class party in your Terminator.
It's kind of awkward.
And it's funny because...
Everyone's, like, ghost or...
Yeah,
like,
you're, like, 4, so most kids were, like... pumpkins and firemen
and
a pirate, and you were like T2 when you were really
another
young.
Cool year. It was like 1 or 2 years after I was Scorpion. Kato was Sub-Zero.
Yeah,
I remember that one. Yeah,
those weren't like official Mortal Kombat costumes, but
it was
we made
close
it work.
Enough.
Yeah.
Cade's was pretty close.
Yeah, his looked
mine was
good.
A Power Ranger and like a knight helmet.
It was like a ninja, but the helmet was not, but it looked like it was the mask when you pulled down the face mask on it. Yeah. That was a fun one, too. Cool. All right. Good choice for number 5, Cade. And it was your number 3, Jet?
Yes.
Okay, cool. I didn't have it on my list, but I really like that pick. All right, Jet, what's your number 5? This is Back to the Future.
Yes.
Okay. This is not John Williams either.
I don't know who it is.
Who is it?
It's not really saying it. It's saying... like someone put this, it's not the actual person.
Okay, I'll look it up, but you talk about why this is your number 5.
This is probably my favorite movie of all time. First or second. Star Wars I count as a franchise. The music is pretty good. But for how I did this episode, I picked one specific score, not as a whole movie. And I think the main theme is just really recognizable.
Yeah,
it is. Iconic.
You do love this movie a lot.
Yeah, you do. You talk about it a lot. You watch it a lot. It's on Netflix.
It's my most watched movie.
I watched...
Do you know how many times you've watched it?
Like, at least 500.
I've seen Back to the Future 500 times. It's Alan Silvestri, by the way. Just looked it up. Yeah, this is a good one for you. And this one also could qualify as soundtrack for you because of The Power of Love. You love that song, too.
Yes. See, you know You know in Ready Player One, the Zemeckis cube?
Yeah.
And he solves it. And the little thing from Back to the Future, the music plays like as he goes back in time.
Yep.
I tried to find that, like, if that's a song or just like a sound for the movie. I couldn't find it anywhere.
It's a sound.
Yeah, so yeah, that would be number one because I love that sound.
Yeah. Oh, good pick. Anything else to say about Back to the Future?
No.
Okay, good pick. All right, I'll go to my number five. Let me get it started here for you. You probably won't recognize it. Don't cheat, kid. I know you saw it.
I did see it.
Chad, let's see if you recognize it.
I wouldn't have gotten it anyway.
This one's kind of obscure.
What does it start with?
F.
Field of Dreams.
Yeah.
How did you do that?
Good job.
I recognize it. I've seen the movie.
So this was one that I will admit partially I picked this because it's not John Williams and I was trying to get others in there. It's composed by James Horner. And it also, I think, qualifies for my list because this movie hits all sorts of feels for me emotionally when I watch it. And that might bias my choice, but I feel like the score really contributes to those emotional moments. And that's what score is supposed to do. It's supposed to add to environment and emotion and kind of like it's supposed to be understated so you don't notice it so much, but it tells you how to feel.
Yeah.
And I really feel the music in this movie when it hits those emotional moments. So it's almost like a guide for how you're supposed to feel. And when you have those emotional moments plus the mystical ones that are kind of in this movie, the score really kind of captures that for me. So I picked Field of Dreams for my number five. I couldn't find the actual song clip from that I was thinking of that I wanted to play, but this is a good one too. It's called The Cornfield. It's also the main theme. So my number five is Field of Dreams.
That's a good pick.
Yeah, good pick.
Thank you. Thank you. All right, Cade, let's move on to your
number four.
I know what this is. I'll give Jed a second. I'm glad. I almost put this on my list. I'm glad I didn't because I was hoping.
Jurassic Park.
It is Jurassic Park.
I only got it from that hint because you were talking about it with Mom earlier.
Yeah.
How much you love it. And she's like, that's my number one.
Yeah. This is like, I mean, it's John Williams. And probably outside of Star Wars, this might be his most
recognizable
theme.
I don't know.
Maybe Indiana Jones. I mean, those
Harry Potter.
Yeah, there's a lot of good ones. but I think this one is way up there. And I'll tell you, well, I'll save it for listener choices, but it got number one.
I have a question for you, Cade. Did you do it as how Dad did it or me? Like, did you do it as a movie as a whole or just one specific?
One specific.
Okay, yeah.
But this movie has more than one song you'd recognize. This is the it main does. One. But there are others, too.
Which one plays when they're, like, flying over the water in the helicopter?
I don't know what they're called.
That one's really good. I like that part.
You got to be closer to your mic.
Oh, my bad.
Yeah, but this one, I mean, such great music. Mm-hmm. And I did not put this on my list. Like I said, I'm really glad I didn't. I'm really glad you did, because if nobody did, I was going to swap out one of my other choices to talk about it. Just beautiful. It's perfect.
This movie accomplishes a lot of things. Well, I do think it's a tad bit overrated. But
how? This movie's so good.
People love this. Like, often people consider this like top. I've heard a lot of lists and stuff. It's like top 50 sometimes. People love this movie.
I will say,
I see this movie more on T-shirts than like almost any other movie. You see more Star Wars shirts,
more
obviously,
Star Wars,
but you see a lot of Jurassic Park shirts.
You see, I saw I forgot to tell you, Cade. The other day, after I dropped off Jet, I think it was after I dropped off Jet, I saw a Jurassic Park Jeep Gladiator.
Wait, really?
Cool. Yeah, it was really cool. Yeah, and
I love the design on the car.
I'm Jed. I know what you're saying. This movie gets a lot of love now. I feel like I understand what you're saying about it being overrated, because it probably is a little bit overrated now for how good the movie is. However, it took a long time for this movie to get this amount of love. I feel like it was underrated for 2 decades, and now really? It's finally getting love.
I think, even as a kid, I always thought this movie nailed 2 things. That's obviously the score. And yeah. 2, the effects are better than 90% of movies today.
Yeah, from 1993.
CGI, they need to use more practical and special effects.
Yeah. That looks so real.
Yeah.
The T-Rex, like, really good.
I know I've talked about this movie on the show before, because it was the first book I read that was like an adult book that I chose to read. And I went to opening night and I waited in line to get in. And it was a real movie experience for me. I was 13, 14 years old. I think it was 13. And it was awesome.
Continue.
No, that's okay. But I saw this movie 4 or 5 times in theaters that summer. Mm-hmm. And like you said, Jet, the effects, but it was more than that, because that was also the same time that theaters were getting Dolby at surround sound, and the sound effects in this movie were so good. Mm-hmm. Like shook your seat good, right? And it had this swelling music that's like emotional and really hits the mark with what it's trying to accomplish. And yeah, this is a great choice. This could have been my number one if I'd put it on my list.
I was going to say that 3 movies that surprised me to this day. Star Wars, the horror movie called The Thing, the remake, not the original. And this movie, the effects. It's crazy that they were able to pull it off.
Yeah.
The Thing and Star Wars were low budget too.
Yeah, I know what you mean. Yeah, the effects are awesome, for sure, for sure. Okay, that was what, kid, your number four? All right, Jet, what is your number four?
My number four is... You'll recognize it in a second.
Oh, Home Alone. This isn't the real song, though. Where'd you find this one?
This is a different score in the movie.
This isn't I know the song, but it's not...
Yes, it is.
This is a cover of it, is what I'm saying.
No, it's not.
It is.
This is actually on the soundtrack.
No, it's not. This is a cover of the one on the soundtrack.
It's not. It's actually on the soundtrack. Yeah.
Is this from Spotify?
Yes.
Okay, it's a cover of the one. But Spotify, it's fine. I won't explain it here.
All the others.
It's slightly different than the original, but I know what song you're trying to do.
I almost didn't count this one because it has words, and yeah. I don't know if that's a soundtrack, and it's a choir. I don't know if the songs exist.
Yeah.
But I pick this one because it's more so special in the movie when it happens.
Sure.
Like Kevin... Macaulay Culkin, he was actually a really, really, really good actor for a child, I think.
Yeah.
And this, like, scene, he's talking to the...
Keep going. I wanted to play the one that I queued up to.
He's talking to, like, this priest or whatever. And, like, everything's been happening at an extremely fast pace. All the traps, you see the robbers, like, there's no break. It's constant, you know, entertainment.
Yeah.
And, like, this is the part in the movie where, you're like, he slows down.
Yeah.
And, like... Macaulay Culkin, like, acts, like, you can see the regret, like, in his voice.
Yeah?
I don't know what I'm trying to say.
Well, I like this pick. I actually had this as my number 2 until we talked a little bit before the show, because you were asking if it was okay to include that song, and I'm like, okay, he's got Home Alone, I'll take it off my list. I picked this as number 2, and I have the main title playing now, because it's score that is, like, emotional and effective and all the stuff I described in my last one, but also captures Christmas in it somehow. Like, this feels like a Christmas song to me. Yeah. And it has, like, so the song is like, it's very mischievous.
It sounds like a Harry Potter song.
It does a little bit, yeah. And it's mischievous, right? Because it's Kevin McAllister, yeah. And he's like a mischievous little boy. There's a little bit of ominous in it because there's bad guys trying to break in his house. And then it also feels like Christmas all wrapped up into one song. Like, it's amazing to me. It's perfect. So, really good pick, Jet.
Yeah. I almost considered just picking the main one. Because of what you said, it's perfect. But I feel like this one really makes me, you know...
Hits those feels?
Yeah.
Yeah, I get that.
And given enough time, Kevin McAllister could beat Batman in a fight.
And given enough time...
Enough time to, like, prepare for the fight?
Yeah.
Yeah.
And, like, get information on Batman and, like, find his weakness or something?
Given enough time, Kevin McAllister became Jigsaw.
Oh, from the movie Saw? Never seen Saw.
I watched it.
It's... Pretty okay.
Pretty okay. Yeah. All right. Well, anything else about Home Alone your number 4? Okay. I'll move on to my number 4. And I almost didn't put this so high in my list because it's another one I'd plan on swapping out if somebody else had it. But I included it anyways.
It's Hedwig's theme.
Hedwig's theme from Harry Potter. We just kind of talked about it a little bit. Home Alone, we should have mentioned John Williams. Hedwig's theme from Harry Potter, John Williams also.
I like this theme a lot, don't get me wrong, but Harry Potter, in my opinion, has so many better theme songs.
There's a lot of really good songs in Harry Potter. I picked this one because it's kind of the main one that flows throughout the whole franchise. It's instantly recognizable.
It's like in every movie.
Yeah.
The beginning.
I think it's the most iconic. And it's just another really, really great example of John Williams being the master at capturing the magic and the kind of whimsical feel of this movie and this score. I think this might be the best example of John Williams doing that, right?
Yeah.
Like kind of capturing the feel of a movie in one piece. So it was my choice for Harry Potter. And Jet, this one gives me some nostalgic feels,
this one really gives me nostalgic feels.
Yeah, I didn't have this.
I have one. Well, I guess this is a spoiler, but later down on my list, I have a Harry Potter one. It makes me feel even more nostalgic than this one.
Okay. Well, I picked it. I'm sorry. I have nostalgia for it, even though it wasn't out when I was a kid. It came out when I was like 20 or something, or 21, or my early 20s.
It's kind of nostalgic for me because I read all the books.
Yeah.
And watched the movies.
I remember when you read the books, you were pretty young, second or third grade.
Yeah.
And I missed the boat on the movies at first. I didn't see it, the first one, when it came out. In fact, I remember the first time I watched a part of it was I was a sophomore in college at Arizona, and I got invited to go to a party at this apartment that would eventually be the apartment I moved into. But at the time, I was just meeting the people that lived there, which are the guys that listen to this show. Mm-hmm. Casey and Nick lived in that one, and Evan and Dave lived next door. And this movie was on, Harry Potter was on, and I was kind of like waiting for people to show up and hanging out, and I sat down and I watched it. I'm like, wow, this is really good.
Did you watch all of it? Or
most of it, yeah. I was like drinking and talking at the same time, but that's how I kind of got introduced to Harry Potter, and then I decided to watch all of them.
When I hear the theme, it reminds me of the first two, which are like very similar. They're very like magical, like sort of action adventure.
Yeah.
Then the third one is kind of a wacky time travel fun adventure.
Mm-hmm.
4, 5, and 6... they get dark. It doesn't feel darker. Magical.
Yeah.
Then in 7, you have affairs with Hermione, Jenny, and Ron, and
Harry.
They're all kind of mad at each other because of the amulet.
Yeah.
And then 8. 8's where it ends, right?
8 wraps it up, yeah.
And then it's kind of the finale.
So I watched 1, then I read all 7 books, and then I watched 2 through 8 as they came out. And I feel the kind of the same way you do. I love 1 and 2. They feel kind of the same to me.
I love 3 too.
Well, 1 and 2 feel the same to me. 3 doesn't. I also love 3. It might be my favorite. I don't know. But it's not the same as 1 and 2. 1 and 2 kind of feel the same. Like it's the beginning, kind of that.
It's because they look so young.
That
and,
so like,
that
but like
and
the story,
tone.
The story and the tone are like completely. More. They're more about like the magic of being in this world.
Mm-hmm. And 3, it is different but kind of similar. Like it still has that magic feeling, but you can see like they've matured, you know, like it has a more mature feeling to it, but still wacky and fun.
Yeah.
And, oh my gosh, it gets really dark.
4 and 5 I kind of put in the same category. Maybe 6 starts to get really dark. 7 is like depressing.
Yeah.
And 8 is kind of too, except that it, you know, wraps
out of
up
all
the
movies, the ones I don't like is 4 and 7, because 7, like, it would
I don't
be
like Goblet of Fire.
That's 4.
Yeah. Like 4. 4, it gets, you can tell it's getting darker because Cedric.
Yeah.
You know Cedric Diggory?
Yeah.
He dies.
Uh-huh. Spoiler alert.
And Voldemort's born, and 7 is just dark. There's a scene where, like, Harry and Hermione are just making out, and then Ron, like, gets pissed, and, like, he destroys the amulet. They're all, like, mad at each other. And there's kind of, like, a love triangle, like, I didn't want this in Harry Potter. It used to be special.
Yeah. I mean, I still like them. I just like the
beginning
more. I think
8 ends it pretty well, though.
Yeah, it does. 8's great. Okay.
8's fat, sad, too, though. Whenever
it is.
Dies in the end.
Yeah, one of the twins dies.
Yeah.
Yeah. Spoiler alert.
The one I liked more died. Fred.
I don't know which one it was, but I don't know how you like one more than the other. The same.
Because Fred's more funny.
Not one of them serves like more of a purpose than the other one.
Yeah. All right, let's move on. Good choice. Oh, that was mine. Good choice, me. Hey, Cade, what's your...
Number 3.
This from Star Wars?
Yeah.
This is... is this Luke and Leia's? Or is it...
Just listen.
Okay. Oh, this is Leia and Han. Yeah, Leia and Han.
Nope.
Is it Across
Indiana
the Stars?
Jones.
Yes. Indiana Jones.
Oh, shoot, I was off.
It sounded really like Star Wars. I thought it was Han and Leia's theme at first.
Yeah.
All right, what? Oh, this gives me Lego Indiana Jones 2 vibes. Yeah,
that's why I picked it, because of Lego Indiana Jones 2.
What's the name of this track?
Washington's Ending / Raiders March. Oh, okay,
so this is the last one on the first movie. Yeah.
And this is my favorite one.
Really?
Mm-hmm.
Okay.
I love this one.
So I have this one. I didn't pick this one for my list because I figured you would or somebody would. And I had it as a substitute, you know, as to throw in. But I had a hard time finding the song on Spotify.
I know. It took me some digging.
So I found this one, which is, it's the end credits from Temple of Doom. But obviously it's the main theme.
Yes, yeah, like the most recognizable one.
When you're going through the soundtrack for the first one for Raiders, I couldn't find it on there.
Yeah, I looked too. So I had to like go online and look up like what is it, like where's the song I can find on Spotify that sounds like.
Right.
So. See, here's the thing. Indiana Jones has some really great single scores, but overall, I think the movie score is good. Not great like the other John Williams ones, but the single scores in some of them are amazing.
Interesting. I think it's one of his best.
I think, like some single scores are one of his best work, but like Harry Potter as a whole, I'd say is way better than Indiana Jones because of all the single scores it has that are great.
Interesting. I mean, I think they're both behind Star Wars.
True. Well, this one has his more nostalgia.
I think they're comparable to each other, Indy and Harry Potter.
I think Harry Potter has the most nostalgia with me.
Indy or Harry Potter?
I mean, Indiana Jones.
Indy.
The scores.
Yeah, I mean, we've been watching the movies forever, and then we also played the Lego game.
The Lego game. So much fun. Yeah. Both of them, one and two.
Yeah.
Two was really bad, but it was still so much fun.
One was fun for... I did not like two.
I played a little bit, but not nearly as much as y'all. When I played with Cade would activate cheats, and he would be an Ewok.
Yeah,
and the normal Ewok would just shoot like pebbles, and it sucked. But he put this cheat where it had these purple balls, and whenever he shot, it would explode. He would kill me all the time. No, I'd get so mad.
You can replace them with the little purple balls the X-Wings pick up when they shoot them at the little
kept
towers.
Killing me.
I know
you're talking
like
about.
We would 1v1.
You can replace the rocks with those, and so when you shoot them, they kill everything in sight.
And there's two things.
Was that one of the unlocks you could get from collecting all the
bricks around?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Okay. So we spent so much time collecting those bricks, and then we got it to where you could multiply. So it would be like times two, times two, times two, times two.
It was times two, then times eight, then times 16, and then times 32.
It would like 52. Exponentially multiply. Yeah. So every time we get one brick, we get like 64,000 bricks.
we maxed out in Lego Star Wars with 4 billion coins.
Pretty sure y'all have beat that game 100%. You know, like when you do every single
thing. I
don't
think we ever did 100%.
I don't know.
I don't know if we did or not.
But when
we did almost everything that you could in the game.
The times I did play is either I did like a mission or I'd 1v1 Cade. I'd be like Darth Maul and you'd shoot those little purple balls. I'm like, what are you doing? How are you doing that? It's so dumb. Mm-hmm. Or you'd be a gonk droid and you're like
super gonk droid.
Yeah.
And it made it like super speed. Kamikaze. It could jump super high and explode itself.
That's awesome. I remember that was like the first game we played together. And
it's
we
my
played,
all-time favorite video game.
It's up there for me too. And we played it a lot. We played Indiana Jones. We played the Harry Potter one a lot, too.
Yeah, that one was really fun.
And then you guys started playing more and me less when the other ones came out and you got into different games. But we saw recently they are releasing in October, Jet.
Yes.
It's the Star Wars.
The Complete Saga. So
the other one was called The Complete Saga. This one's called The Skywalker Saga. Yeah.
So it's all
includes 7, 8, and 9. And then they redid 1 through 6. And me and Cade are like crazy excited.
And they don't.
Yeah, I can't wait to do this. It's going to be so much fun.
I don't think they have the spinoffs.
No,
which sucks for Solo, but who cares about Rogue One?
You're such a hater. Are we going to get it for Xbox or PS4?
PS4 is a better experience, but you can...
We can do Xbox, because we can do it upstairs.
We can do either one upstairs.
Yeah.
Oh, I forgot.
Also, if y'all are going to play, you should do it upstairs. And
I don't know. I like the Xbox controller better.
We can do
it's
Xbox.
It's simpler.
Okay. Xbox it is. All right. All right, good pick. So that was Indiana Jones. That was your number three?
Mm-hmm.
All right, Jet, what's your number three?
Oh, mine was Terminator.
Terminator, we already talked about it. Okay, we'll go to mine. Jay, you should know this by now.
I don't.
Really? I'm shocked. I thought you'd get this right away. I'll give you another clue in a second if you don't get it. All right, it's written by the Dust Brothers. Does that help?
What is it?
It's my favorite movie of all
Fight
time.
Club?
Fight Club, yes. This is a
cool song.
Yeah.
This is not on my list, but I want to play another one from Fight Club.
It sounds
that
like
is
a,
an honorable mention.
It sounds like a Nine Inch Nails beat.
It kind of does. It's the score for Fight Club is all like this. It's all by the Dust Brothers. Incidentally, happens to be my favorite movie ever, composed entirely by just the Dust Brothers, and they do have some soundtrack songs in there too. But the Pixies. Every song is like brooding and kind of dark and ominous, and it perfectly fits in with the movie and its surroundings. Jack's sense of musical taste says it's perfect. This could have been my number one easily.
I will say, Back to the Future is my favorite movie, but Fight Club is a better movie for sure than Back to the Future.
Yeah.
You know, just how Empire is better than A New Hope, but some people like A New Hope more.
Right.
When Empire is better in a way, but you can like a movie more even though you know it's...
Sure.
The Avengers is better than Weird Science, but I like Weird Science more.
Me too. All right, play the one you were going to play, Jet.
All right, I'm going to... The first minute is kind of whatever, so I'm just going to skip to the part.
Oh, I know which one you're doing. Yeah, go ahead. This is what plays at the DVD intro menu. Yeah.
This is a perfect one because the beginning is just super, like, it's basically what you said. It sets the tone. It's like just a normal movie, kind of like weird,
dark,
and then like it gets intense, like the fighting part.
Yeah, yeah.
It's called Stealing Fat, which I wish I had a cooler name, but
Stealing Fat. Well, that's from Stealing Fat.
Stealing Fat.
You remember the scene
like,
in the
movie? Yeah, actually,
yeah. Yeah, they go to like a liposuction clinic and they steal the bags of fat and they turn that into soap that they then sell back to the women that donated the fat, not donated, but paid for their liposuctions. So yeah, I love this movie. Fight Club's my number three.
Another thing, I don't really know if the movie is kind of supernatural in a way. Like, I get that it's just himself and he's insane and he's seeing himself. And the times where you see him and you see the narrator looking at Tyler, it's actually Tyler imagining the narrator looking at him.
Yeah.
But the scene where he's beating himself up and he's like pulling
himself,
like, you can't really do that, I feel like. Like, pull, he's like, he has his hand here. And he's just, like, dragging himself across the floor.
That's what he's seeing.
Oh, I guess that's his point of view.
Right. Mm-hmm.
I thought that was actually what was happening. I'm like, how is that happening?
No, that's what he's seeing, right? I mean, he's constructing that environment. All right, good pick for me again. Why do I keep telling myself good pick?
It was a good pick, though.
So that's my number three. Cade, let's move on to your...
Number two.
Number two.
Whoa. Is this what I was going to choose? Binary Sunset is my number two.
So, okay.
This is my number one.
So, this is the there's a bunch of them that are the Force theme, but they're a little bit different. Like, Binary Sunset, my number one's a different one of the Force theme, but they're all different in a way, so it's basically the Force theme.
Yeah, the Binary Sunset, at least, is based on the Force theme. Mm-hmm. Whatever you picked might be also.
Mine is a little bit different. A little bit, you can definitely hear the difference in this one.
Yeah.
Then Binary Sunset sounds almost identical.
The thing with Star Wars, I mean, you have the main... We should turn this up so people can hear it. The main title sequence is what everybody knows.
Imperial March.
And the Imperial March, yes. That's dun-dun-dun-dun-dun-dun.
Yeah.
Dun, dun. And then the Force theme, which is what's playing right here, is actually the most played theme in the movies.
They just like change it up a little bit, right?
Yeah, they weave it into all these other moments and songs. It's also Obi-Wan's theme. It's prevalent throughout all the movies.
Was this meant to be number one? You played it on accident?
No. This is my number two.
And Star Wars has, I mean, I don't know how you can like
really. Should I just play my number one?
Sure, when it's your turn. I don't really know how you can dispute when you're talking movie scores, how you can really, like, if you're just being... Obviously, we're biased. We love Star Wars. Exactly. But if you're looking at it objectively, I don't know how you could pick anything over Star. I mean, I know it's subjective in nature because it's opinion on what you like, but the score is so rich and so heavy, and there are so many good songs. Mm-hmm. It's like unbelievable. It's John Williams' best work, and he's the best of all time. I don't know how you could pick anything else. Anything else to add about yours, Cade?
I don't know.
I might just play my number one right now.
Like when it plays, and then they're on Tatooine.
Yeah,
that moment right there, like Tatooine and that song go together like peanut butter and jelly.
Yeah.
Like,
so I mean, I had it as my number one, so I'll go ahead and talk about it now. And hold on yours, Jet, because mine's the exact same moment. I'm gonna play
and
it
seeing,
real quick.
And seeing the two sons is so sad.
Yeah, hold on. I had it queued up too, but mine is on YouTube because it like specifies that exact moment. So it's when Luke he's coming fresh off the news that his family's dead.
He's like kicking rocks and he's upset.
He's not kicking rocks, but he's like sad. And
he is kicking rocks. He kicks a rock.
But You made me lose my train of thought. But he's realizing that destiny is calling to him. This is the moment right here. It's calling him on the hero's journey. He's got to take this quest now after the death of his family. He stares off into the twin setting suns on Tatooine, and the variation of the Force theme plays that we talked about before, and it's just emotional and perfect.
Mm-hmm. It's also perfect in The Rise of Skywalker when that's the last shot ever.
True.
So I'll just play mine, okay. Number one, because it's basically the Force theme.
Okay. Is yours from The Rise of Skywalker?
No. It plays two times and then...
Okay,
and
well then let me hear it and then I'll try to guess where it's from. Oh, this is hard.
Yo, this is not even the part, yeah.
Okay.
It's a little bit sadder or more intense than the Force theme.
Okay, it's coming to me. Hold on.
It plays twice in the entire series.
This is Return of the Jedi?
No.
Okay, I don't know. Tell me.
Here's, turn it down. Okay, so it plays twice, and one of them is one of my favorite parts in all of Star Wars. One, it's called Burning Homestead because it's when he first sees Uncle Owens and Aunt Beru, and they're like bacon.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
So that's when you first hear it. And it plays again in The Force Awakens, and Rey takes the lightsaber from the snow.
Okay.
And in that moment, it's just one of my favorite moments because of the score.
Yeah.
It's basically the Force theme, but a little bit more like sadder, intense, and like heroic.
So, okay, good pick for both of you. I mean, I knew Star Wars was going to be on our list somewhere. Interesting, it's your number two, Kate.
Mm-hmm. You curious to see what my number one is?
I am, yeah. And Jet, that was your number one?
Yeah, so,
okay, so
now we're doing number...
It'll be your number two, yeah.
All right, this is the Harry Potter one I was talking about. You'll recognize it when it gets to the 15-second mark. I bet you y'all won't be able to name the moment it happens to.
Will or won't?
Will.
Okay.
Happens twice, but one of them's pretty obvious.
You said the 15-second mark?
Yes.
Okay. This is reminding me of when he first gets to Hogwarts, maybe?
No.
The train?
No. Well, yes, the train when he leaves, yes. And the other one's when you look in the mirror.
Oh, the mirror of Erised?
Yes. This one is probably... Well, this and the Terminator one made me feel so nostalgic.
Yeah.
This makes me feel sad whenever I listen to it.
Yeah. It is sad. Kind of melancholy.
Yeah.
I like it.
There's a lot of others I was considering. There's one just called, it's Christmas or something.
Is it when he's at Hogsmeade?
No, it's just, hold on. It's just when it's Christmas.
Yeah. We need to go back to Universal.
Yes, we do.
It's just Christmas at Hogwarts.
Oh, yeah.
It makes me feel happy.
Yeah.
This and the scene when they first sit down at the table and they get all the food appears. Yeah. Like those are happy moments. Good picks, Jet. Right, so that's your number two. Anything else to add?
No.
Okay. We'll go to my number two, and I guess this will be our last one because we already talked about me and Jet's number one. Kate still has his number one.
Yep.
All right. So my number two is right here.
What is this?
It's John Williams.
Oh. Jurassic Park?
Nope.
What is it?
Feel good, magical, sweeping, swelling emotions. I'll give you some more clues. No, this is the if I think of like going to the theaters and seeing a movie, this is the movie I think of. Ultimate cinematic experience.
I don't know.
It was the biggest movie of all time when it came out. E.T. Thank you very much.
Ugh.
It just feels like the perfect movie theater movie, and a big part of that is the score. I really love it, and it's like you recognize the song, like you hear it, and you're like, I know this song. Yeah. It's not one of his most famous. Like you can't say right away that's Star Wars, that's Indiana Jones, but. Still recognizable. It fits the movie really well. And I think it's one of his best songs ever for John Williams. I really like it. And the score for the entire movie is really good. It's not just the song, but this one's kind of the main one. It's when they, this is the flight when they take off on their bikes across the moon.
Isn't it crazy that they're canon in Star Wars?
Yeah, yeah. The
Phantom Menace, you can see them.
Yeah, I've told that that entire kind of theory on the show
it's,
before.
It's true, they're there.
Like, I know.
They're just chilling.
Do you remember what the species name is?
No.
Grebleeps. You know why it's easy to remember?
Spielberg.
It's Spielberg backwards, yeah.
Grebleeps.
They're in the Star Wars universe.
Yeah. He's a Jedi. He can fly. He can heal people. He's a Jedi.
He can fly?
Yeah, he makes the bikes fly across across the moon.
Maybe a flying Jedi.
So, if that's the case, then does that mean E.T.'s canon?
Yeah.
And if that's the case, then does that mean Earth is canon?
Yeah. No. I mean, if E.T. is canon and makes it to Earth. But, you know, he wasn't a long time ago in a galaxy far, far away.
Yeah, he is.
Not, he's on not Earth? In the movie.
When he's on Earth, it's
we don't ever see him 19? Anywhere else. 1980, 82, 81. Okay, so E.T. is my number two. That leaves just one pick. It's Cade's number one, and I am curious to know what this is. Jed, don't look.
I have not changed this.
I'm not looking.
Like,
I can't even see it.
I stuck with this one.
Oh, it's
this
the
is
footsteps.
Race theme.
Mm-hmm. Oh, I love race theme.
Is it Jedi steps or race theme?
It's race theme.
It's race theme. That's what I thought. Yeah, this is when she's sliding down.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah,
I love this part.
I thought about this when I was picking a Star Wars song. I considered this one for mine too.
I really like this song. Kylo Ren has a really good theme too.
Yeah, he does.
It's way different.
Yeah, John. I mean, for whatever the sequel trilogy might have lacked compared to the original trilogy, the music still hit for me
definitely.
Very much,
especially in the first one.
Yeah,
Force Awakens.
Rey's theme, Kylo Ren's theme is really good, and they mixed in a lot of the old themes well.
Yeah,
that's John Williams at like 85, 87 years old, 89 Jeez. Years old, still composing these songs. He's just the master. I think though, Jedi Steps is probably my favorite song.
Similar to race that, to race them.
It does sound similar, but that moment in the movie is also just very kind of cool when she's finally walking up the steps. Yeah, this part. To finally
yeah, this, this one's better.
Yeah.
It's just this theme makes me very disappointed.
Well, for what happens in The Last Jedi, but not what happens in
so
The Force Awakens.
Yeah, just think about like when you first saw this. In the
it was
Force
one.
Awakens.
It's one of my favorite movie endings ever. Like, even before that, it wraps everything up perfectly.
Yeah.
Like, it has a little bit of mystery because of Finn. Like, will he be okay? A little bit of sadness because of Han.
Yeah.
And just all the characters, their arcs are kind of ending.
Yeah.
And then you get this amazing twist. Not really a twist, just this amazing shock value at the end when Luke turns around. It's just perfect. And then the next movie is just ruined.
Yeah. Well, that is the worst movie in the entire Star Wars.
Well, no, like second or third.
We're always going to fight about this. But yeah, I do love this song. And I like Rey's theme a lot, too.
Clone Wars is better than The Last Jedi.
Agreed.
Well, Clone Wars ranks pretty high in Star Wars content ever.
We were actually talking about this earlier. Jet and I were, I think it was Jet. Yeah, Jet asked me what the coolest looking superhero was, mm-hmm. and we ended up talking about Jedi a little bit too.
Iron Man is the coolest.
Okay, but who's the coolest looking Jedi?
A canon?
Yeah, movies only.
Movies only.
Let him pick before you say anything, because we've already discussed it.
I like Anakin.
Okay.
Me too.
In the prequels.
So like his dark black outfit,
perfectly
that Jet picked also
captures his personality.
It matches his hair, and it looks really cool with the blue lightsaber.
Yeah, I picked Rey. Perfect. I think Rey's the coolest looking Jedi.
Really?
Yeah, I love her outfit. I think she looks.
What about
awesome.
The gray one? And
I like all of them, but my favorite one is the Force Awakens.
Mine is the Rise of Skywalker because it's basically the Force Awakens, but it's a little bit of Jedi touch. It adds the hood. It's like more white.
Mm-hmm.
Also, she looked awesome as a Sith. Sith.
Yes. She looked really cool. She was like wearing Kylo Ren's like exact outfit pretty much.
Yeah.
Like the little band he has like around his stomach.
Yep.
And her teeth.
Yeah. Yeah. She
got the Melina teeth.
Baraka. All right, cool. So that concludes all of our list really, because I had number one as Binary Sunset from Star Wars, and you had number one as the
Burning Homestead.
So yeah, that brings us to honorable mentions. I guess I'll play the bumper here. I just didn't have the volume ready. Sorry.
Do y'all have your
honorable mentions?
Honorable mentions. what's it called, like on your list?
I did queue up a couple, but I don't have to play them because we already played some.
So like, Cade will go first.
Pretty much all of mine are what we said and talked through.
What about you, Jeff? What else did you have?
I have two.
Okay.
One is from a movie that is overrated, but I think the music is actually pretty good. It's called Time.
The song is called Time?
This is from Inception.
Oh, you talked about this before. I watched Inception with you, and I've heard that this soundtrack is great. Like, I saw it online a lot.
Really good.
But I don't remember noticing the music at all when I watched the movie.
This one's pretty recognizable just in general.
And I didn't love this movie. I mean, I thought it was very overrated.
Yeah, I think it's very overrated. When I first saw it, this tricked me just like a lot of other things trick people. I thought the ending was so good, so I thought maybe this movie is as good as everyone says. But then I remember, a movie can have a great ending, but can be a horrible film.
Yeah.
Rogue One, for example.
I knew you were going to go there.
I really hate Rogue
One. So for Inception, for me, was weird because it seems like the type of movie I would love. Like the kind of mental thriller twist. With Leonardo DiCaprio, who's like one of my favorite actors, and like I just think it feels like a movie I would love, and it's super highly rated. And I went and I watched it, and I was like, just predictable.
I think everything, like, is just average.
Yeah, it was predictable.
It was a long movie.
And have you seen it?
Yeah.
I didn't. I don't hate it. I like it fine, but I think it's very overrated.
I feel like it would be like 7.2 or 3 on IMDb, not like number 13
of all time. Yeah, I agree.
And I have one more.
Okay, what is it?
I didn't like the scene where they're in the snow and shooting each other.
I don't even remember it.
You don't remember?
Mm-mm.
You don't remember that, Jack?
Yeah, I do. It's just kind of average. Like, the action isn't even great.
Yeah.
Even like
they're just running around in the snow shooting at each other. Like, not even cool.
Yeah.
And like the effects.
Oh, I know what you're talking about. It's when they go inside of a dream, inside of a dream, inside of a dream.
The effects are great, but there was other really great effects in movies after
Jurassic Park.
Way earlier too.
So this one is from Halloween. I didn't want to pick the main theme, and this one just sounds.
How do you not pick the main theme? That is clearly the best song from that movie.
Anyways, this one just sounds really cool, but it's just not good enough to make my top five.
Okay, play it. Yeah, nobody even would recognize this one.
Yeah, I don't even.
It's called "The Shape Hunts Allison." It's not even from the original.
Oh.
I'm this definitely is very not very obscure. Record. Yeah.
It sounds cool, though.
Yeah. But the original is iconic. I mean, the main theme, I should say, not the original. The main theme is iconic, and some people voted for that one for listener choices.
I thought you would have put Stranger Things on your list.
Yeah, me too, because you made sure we included TV shows on this, and you didn't even include the TV show.
You've been listening to...
So you came up with the idea for this episode while watching Stranger Things.
I have an honorable mention, Stranger Things.
It didn't even make your honorable mentions.
No, it did. I just forgot to play it. It's called Kids.
Yeah, he showed me this one.
This one's perfect.
Yeah. That's a good point that it didn't even make your...
God, I love this thing.
Did you just forget when you were putting your list together? Okay.
It would have probably maybe crapped my top. I don't know if it would.
Their soundtrack is so good.
It is very good.
This is the best one by far. It sounds like kind of 80s.
Oh, very 80s synth.
Also, it's just amazing.
Do you like this more than the main theme?
Yes, for sure.
I like this one more than the main theme.
There's the good parts almost coming up. I'll play a couple more, but this is the best one.
We don't have to play 18 songs from it, but this is a good song. I like this one too. Any other honorable mentions?
No.
Do you want to play any other songs from Stranger Things?
Just said no.
You can play another one. I just don't want to play. Man. I don't want to play the whole soundtrack.
The synthesizer, second coolest this is the instrument.
Cool part. Yeah.
Behind.
Guitar.
They're also very 80s.
Yeah, both of those. Put those in a song together, and you'll have like the greatest hit of all time.
Instant hit.
Yeah. Okay. There was a regular show episode about synthesizers.
Oh really?
Yeah, on a planet called Synthos, where people lived. And everything they did was playing through a synthesizer. Huh. It was really cool.
Hold on, I'm trying to find it.
All right, well, okay, here it is.
This one's really good.
What's this one called?
It's called The First I Love You. The original was in season 2. It's called The First Lie, but this one is different.
Mm. You recently rewatched the whole series.
Yes.
That's where the idea for this episode came from. It's because you were watching it and kind of really digging the music, and you're like, oh, we should do...
Scores.
And you made sure we included TV scores so you could have this. and not just movie scores.
This one's really good too.
I don't even recognize this one, but I haven't watched the show in a long time. Is there going to be a season 4?
Yes.
Okay. Is it this year?
No, I don't think so. It's not even a trailer out.
We had Mandalorian this year.
Yes, we do. And we were going to do an episode for that. A recap of season 1 and prediction for season 2. Yeah, October. Also, I saw today, I don't know if you guys have seen this, Obi-Wan series, Ewan McGregor confirmed as the lead actor.
No way.
Probably 2022. But Ewan McGregor talked about it in an interview. So it's going to happen. Yes.
That's awesome.
Super excited for that. All right. I had a couple of honorable mentions. We talked about most of them. I'm going to play a clip from one here that I couldn't include it on my list because it's really only one part of one song that qualifies, and the rest of the score doesn't mean anything to me. Mm-hmm. But this part is awesome and memorable and has been the ringtone on my phone for a couple of years now.
It's the baseball, the natural?
Yeah, the natural. Just really cool theme.
I thought this would easily make your top five.
Well, it's only that part of that one song.
Every time you got a call.
Yeah, and they play it at, you know, a lot of baseball stadiums, including the Ranger Stadium, when they hit a home run. So, yeah, kind of a cool theme, but there's not anything outside of that that would qualify.
You know what I thought would have made your list? Rocky.
It made my list in one way.
That's my worst.
We're getting there. My other honorable mentions, Lord of the Rings, Gladiator. Gladiator is so good. I had a really hard time leaving that off my list. Hook, which is another John Williams, and Robin Hood, Prince of Thieves, which is like not many people know that one, but the music's really good.
Fun fact of the week, the actor Rufio in Hook, Dante Bosco, voices Zuko.
In Avatar, yeah, true. And then I had two movies. I almost put one of these on. I had Disney movies because the songs written for those movies are original for that movie, so they're score. But they're like lyrical songs, whereas I kind of didn't want to do lyrical songs for this. But The Little Mermaid and Aladdin, I love the music from those a lot.
Little Mermaid is my favorite.
Me too. The Little Mermaid is the one I was going to put on my list. The thing with that is like even the Oscars had a hard time kind of defining this as score because when The Little Mermaid came out, there was The Little Mermaid, Beauty and the Beast, Lion King, and Aladdin, and all four of those won the Oscar for Best Musical Score.
Really?
Yeah. Disney dominated that category for like 4 or 5 years. And then after that happened, the Oscars were like, oh, we need a separate category for this. So they have Best Musical Score, and then they also have Best Score that's Broadway, basically, or comedy. And that's where all the Disney ones went at that point.
Okay.
And then I think at some point they brought them back together. But for that stretch where they were winning everything, they had a hard time separating it, just like I did for this list. I couldn't put it on my list because it was different in its own way. Yeah. But if I had put one on there, it would have been Little Mermaid.
Little Mermaid, not Aladdin.
I mean, I love Aladdin, but I think I like the Little Mermaid songs a little bit better. All right. So that's it for my honorable mentions. We can go to
The worst.
What you got, Cade?
This might come as a surprise, but I don't like this.
Is this Jaws?
Mm-hmm.
You don't like Jaws?
I don't like the Jaws.
The theme is really good for Jaws.
Yeah.
I don't know. I never liked it.
It's very simple.
Very menacing and honestly very influential too.
I think I heard it too much in like memes and stuff, and it just kind of ruined the factor.
Yeah, it's been parodied a lot.
Oh, the song again.
This is John Williams.
I know.
And he played this on a tuba, and when he took it to the guys, I don't know the guy's name, whoever was playing it, said, I want this on a tuba. The dude was like, no, this should be on some other instrument that made more sense. He's like, no, I think a tuba would be more menacing. So they took it to Steven Spielberg, and he thought he was joking. Like, this is it. And then it worked, like, perfectly. Like, it became instantly famous, right? And recognizable. So, but I get it. It's been parodied a lot. And
yeah.
2015, the shark still looks fake. Y'all won't get the reference.
Back to the Future?
Two,
yeah.
It looks really bad, but
the 3D shark that jumps out, and the Cubs were in the World Series,
which
ended up really happening in 2015.
That's crazy.
Yeah,
everyone talks about the Simpsons predicting the future.
Also, another,
but it was actually Back to the Future.
Yeah,
another honorable mention is from Predator. That has a good score too. Yeah. It just came to my mind.
What's your worst?
I had Rocky.
You want to play it or no?
No.
Okay.
You don't want to hear it?
Okay, so first of all, it has a horrible soundtrack, and the main theme is kind of bad, too.
Yeah. I mean, I agree, because the main theme is Eye of the Tiger, which...
It's like the worst song to ever be created.
I hate that song.
That's
so annoying.
And then the main theme, I agree, Jed. I don't really like it either. This is it here. I had it queued up because it's not my worst, but I was going to talk about it.
Sounds really dumb.
Yeah, I think what it
sounds
is...
Sounds cheap.
It sounds cheesy. It's very kind of like 70s, like disco, not disco, but like it has a very 70s kind of dance vibe to it. And that's the time it came out in. But there are some songs that like... They came out during a certain time, but they're timeless because they continue to be good. This song to me just sounds very dated. Yeah. But people love this song. A lot of people pick this song, Listener Choices. Just not for me. So I get it, Jed. I agree with you. But it was not my worst.
What is your worst?
Well, I was going to go with Rocky initially, but then instead of picking that, because I just don't like that song, instead I went with a song that the movie is good and it's gigantic and everybody knows it and everybody's seen it, but the theme song is so crazy forgettable that I would never recognize it. Jet might because he pays attention to this stuff, but I don't think most people recognize it. So I'm going to go ahead and play it and then you guys can guess what it's from. Jet will probably get it.
Oh. The Avengers.
Yeah. I figured you would get it, Dad. But, like, no one knows this song.
A lot of people know this song.
A lot of people know this song.
It's become huge.
It's very recognizable, like, to everyone.
Yeah.
Well, maybe I'm wrong, then.
In the past...
This is very forgettable to me.
It was big, but not huge, when The Avengers came out. Infinity War came out, everyone knew this song.
Yeah, definitely. It's become... Infinity War was really big with the media.
And I'm going to be honest, I actually really like the theme. I think it's really, really good.
Hmm. I don't. I this is so boring to me. Like, this song is... I would venture to say it's awful. And I don't really... I mean, the movie's huge. The music to me is very, very, very forgettable.
Do you like it, King?
I mean, it's all right. I just think the Avengers are all right in general. But
yeah, I'm not a huge Avengers fan, so maybe I'm...
I'll watch them because, like, I want to watch them. Yeah. But every time I watch them, it's just like, it's all right.
I still haven't seen Endgame.
Two things.
I think you should. I think it's worth a watch.
DC has better heroes, in my opinion. Just the movies are bad.
DC movies are awful. Yeah.
Marvel has
the Dark Knight sucks. I watched it.
It's so weird.
I hate it. It's boring and it's stupid and everything's dark in the movie. You can't see anything.
Well, no. It's overrated. It's not a bad movie.
And the Dark Knight Rises. I don't like them at all.
All right, we've talked about this a lot on this show, so let's move on. Do you have anything else to add about the worst?
Nope.
No. Okay, let's move on. Listener choices. We have social media. What's your favorite movie or TV score? And we got a lot of responses. I'm not going to say all of them because there were a bunch of ties, but I'll tell you what the top three were. Number three was Star Wars.
Okay.
How's that not number one?
Because there was a tie for number one between Last of the Mohicans, which I saw in the 90s and haven't seen since then, so I don't remember the music from it, but a lot of people picked that one, tied with Jurassic Park as number one. So according to our listeners, Last of the Mohicans and Jurassic Park are the best movie scores of all time.
I agree with Jurassic Park.
It's a good pick.
Pew, pew, pew,
good.
Pew.
Glenn Solomon, fun fact of the week.
Pew, pew, pew,
good.
Pew.
So we talked about John Williams a lot on this episode, and I figured I'd give a fun fact about him. He's been nominated for 51 Academy Awards, which is the second most of all time behind Walt Disney. 6 Emmys, 25 Golden Globes, 67 Grammys, and 15 BAFTAs. The dude is a legend, obviously, but that is not the fun fact. His incredibly long and impressive list of memorable movie scores is not the fun fact either. The fun fact is that musical talent runs in his family. His dad and his brothers were all musicians too, but his son is the lead singer of Toto.
Famous. Wait, really?
Yeah.
I had no idea. John Williams' son is the lead singer of Toto?
Yeah,
I had no idea.
His name is Joseph. And
I wonder if this song is so good.
Best known for this song.
Crazy, yeah. Someone as popular or as famous like John Williams' son was even bigger than him.
This song's not bigger than him, no.
Yes, it's bigger than his whole career.
Huh?
This song is bigger than his whole career.
Everyone does this song. All my friends know this song.
It's a great song, but he's not bigger than John Williams.
Oh, he for sure is. More people recognize his name. I already knew this fact. It's not
What's his name?
A fun fact. Joseph.
You actually listened to that part?
Yeah, Joseph Williams. It's just, no, I didn't listen. I just knew his name.
No, because you sat up and you said, wait, what? Whose son is what? You had to... So, yeah, Jacob or Joseph Williams.
That's crazy.
That was just for you, Jet. We'll let Total play us out. Hey, Jet, do you have a pun of the week?
Yes. Come on. You gonna do it?
Okay, fine. I was gonna play Africa. We'll do both. Is this confusing?
No.
It's time for Jet's.
This one's good. Of the week.
All right, what you got?
There's a sale at the mall.
The Darth Mall?
Everything's half off.
Oh, I get
it. That one's pretty good.
Yeah, but you didn't make it up.
No, I did.
No, I've seen it before. But I like it. It's a good pun. Good job. All right, that'll wrap up our show. Thank you to everybody for taking the time to listen. You can check out our Facebook page if we had one, but it's down right now, so don't. Give us a review on iTunes. We love those. You can help give us some valuable feedback there and help us to kind of gain some exposure on iTunes. And you can write us, 521podcast@gmail.com. And you can call us, 469-607-521. That's 469-607-5861. Please join us next time on 521 for our discussion on...
Top 5.
Do you remember?
Yeah, I do. Just give me a second. It's top 5. Oh, we're not going to do desserts.
Desserts, yes. Top 5 desserts.
I'm excited for this one. I love dessert.
Me too.
But we're...
Love you.